implementing constraints in MySQL 5.x. In this nugget, we begin to fine-tune our data entry in MySQL tables by understanding, first of all, what provisions did the MySQL development team add in order for us as DBAs to handle missing or invalid data values. We're concerned in this nugget with improving and maximizing the data integrity of our database. Second, we'll take up a very important question, especially for those DBAs who have experience with other RDBMSs, and that is, can we leverage the check constraint in MySQL to, again, ensure data that comes into the table is meeting our business and logical needs? And then finally, we'll look at table-level constraints. We'll look at things that you can do, like add nullability, we'll look at default values, and we'll also look at foreign key constraints, all three of which provide nice ways in MySQL to ensure data integrity. Handling invalid data values in MySQL. As I said in the opening of this nugget, we're concerned with maximizing data integrity in our tables. In other words, we want to make sure that whoever the data entry operator is prevented from incompletely adding row data to our base tables. If data is required for a field, how can we make sure that that happens? Now, by default, MySQL runs in a fairly permissive mode, and therefore you may see zeroing out or truncation for out of range or improper values. And that's just by design how MySQL has been developed. It's forgiving in its data handling. So in other words, you'll find that MySQL Server by default will convert erroneous input values to their closest legal values, and even at times, perhaps even change a data type on you, such that if a data type comes in that's not exactly what's expected in the column, MySQL may change that data type on the fly in order to be as forgiving of the data as possible. Another example is if you attempt to store a negative value in a column that is unsigned, you'll remember that decimals can be signed or unsigned, that MySQL will convert that value, whatever it is, to zero, which is the nearest legal value for an unsigned column. And immediately, you may be thinking to yourself one of two things. One, well, that's pretty cool that MySQL is forgiving and can smooth out some minor bumps in data entry. On the other hand, you may be more like me, where I don't want MySQL making any automatic changes, especially where truncation, zeroing, or just absolute data modification might take place if out of range or improper values are inserted into the database table. So what can we do about this? One way to configure MySQL to better handle missing or invalid or out of range data values is to set a different SQL mode. I referenced the SQL mode earlier in this course, and we're going to visit it again now. There's actually a number of modes to choose from, each having various levels of strictness on how MySQL handles data that's not exactly matching in data type to what a column expects. You have strict all tables and strict trans tables. The difference between these two would be whether or not you're using a storage engine that supports transactions. Strict transactional tables will put the input value checking in a rigorous format, but only apply it to tables for which you have a transaction-based storage engine like InnoDB. Transactions are a really good thing for DBAs because they ensure that if, for instance, invalid data comes into a table and we have an SQL mode set to strict or traditional, then that transaction will be rolled back. By default, when you're using a non-transactional storage engine like MyISAM, you may in fact get incomplete updates, where if you were doing a whole batch of updates at once, half of them might commit, then you might get one that gets rejected due to your SQL mode, and then the rest of them might commit as well. So if you don't want stuff like that to happen, you'll want to A, change your storage engine to a transaction-based one, like, as I said, InnoDB, and B, you want to set a stricter SQL mode, like trans tables, or traditional is actually the strictest mode for handling missing or invalid data. Does MySQL support the check constraint? If you come from another relational database management system, I'm sure you're familiar with a constraint type called check. In a nutshell, check allows you to provide some kind of mathematical or logical basis to screen data input on a column. In other words, you could put a check constraint on a salary column to ensure that values going into that column are between X value and Y value. Or you could create a check constraint to ensure that only numeric-based data or only string data gets added to that column. Primarily, though, check constraints are used for comparison operators to constrain the type of data being added to a column. The check constraints are really handy thing for a DBA and a database designer to have. Of course, the question is, does MySQL support the check constraint? And unfortunately, the answer is yes, but no. Now, what does that mean? It sounds like some kind of Zen koan. Yes, in as much as you'll see references to the check constraint in the MySQL reference manual, but no, MySQL as of 5.x, 5.1 is the version that's current as of this recording, check constraints are not officially supported by any storage engine. Now, that comes as a big bummer to you, probably. Comes as a bummer to me and to a lot of MySQL DBAs. Therefore, if you do a Google search for check constraints in MySQL, you'll find that a lot of MySQL developers think of interesting or novel ways to get around this limitation in MySQL. The most common is to create what's called a trigger and attach that trigger code to a column that emulates check data validation. All right? Now, we're going to discuss triggers later on in this course. For now, I'll just define a trigger as a piece of code that you can create and store persistently in your MySQL database and then attach to one or more columns in your tables. Triggers provide a lot of different things. Triggers can automate database administration tasks. Triggers can be used for auditing and security purposes. And then, of course, in this context, you can put code in that trigger to check whether data coming into a column meets whatever business parameters you have in mind. So that's what we've got going as far as getting as close as possible to the check constraint support in MySQL. Supplemental approaches to handling missing or invalid data values in MySQL are as follows. 1, column nullability. In the demo, we're formally going to take up a consideration of nullability. You'll recall that when we issue a create table statement, by default, all of your columns will allow nulls. And null is kind of a tricky word. You'll get different definitions of null depending upon which RDBMS you're looking at the documentation for. In MySQL, a null value is simply a missing value. And in MySQL terminology, we can never assume that two values in the same column that are null, in other words, there's no data being stored, are equal. In other words, nulls are never considered equal because really, a null value is considered an unknown value. But anyway, we can issue during our column definition statements in create table the not null keyword to prevent nulls from being added to a column. That's one really quick and easy way to provide data integrity in our database tables. In other words, we have a salary column and an employees table. Every employee, by definition, is going to have a salary. So if we wanted to ensure that at least something is stored in that column for every row, we would attach not null to the column definition. Another supplemental approach is to use column defaults. Here, again, during create table or alter table, for a column, we can add the keyword default, a space, and then a value that's automatically slam dunked into that column for every row that's added to the table. Defaults are useful, for instance, if most or at least a large percentage of rows in that table will have the same value. Let's say you're doing an employee table and there's a state field and well over 90% of your employees live in the state of Tennessee. You can ease data entry and minimize, if only by a small percentage, the human error aspect of putting in bad data by providing a default space TN, for instance, and then just letting the data entry operator pass by the state column unless an employee lives in a state besides Tennessee. Third, we have data types. First, you might not think that data type is a way to enforce data integrity, but it really is. For instance, if you add the decimal or the integer data type to a column, then MySQL is going to bark if you put in a string. And matter of fact, depending upon the SQL mode, you may find if somebody put a string value into an integer data type, depending upon what the string was, if the string were numbers, you may find very much that SQL behaving by its default SQL mode will convert that data type for you. Again, that may or may not be what you want. Take-home message, data types provide another way to track and enforce certain data in your database table columns. How about the foreign key constraint? Now, this bears some further discussion because really the idea of the foreign key and the idea of related tables is the heart of a relational database management system as opposed to, say, a flat file database. Now, first, how about the point of relating tables? Why would we want to relate two tables in a database? Well, to review, one is to avoid data redundancy. In this case, we have a table called film that tracks fields related to, I guess we can assume, movies. And we have another table that we've created that tracks actors in, we presume, those films. Now, we could include the actor information in the film table, but we're going to wind up with a lot of redundancy, aren't we? Because certainly a single actor is going to be in more than one film, or vice versa. Therefore, in the name of maintaining that much-respected third normal form, we're going to break out our tables as granularly as possible to reduce any redundant fields and reduce any possibility that a single column will contain more than one unique value. In other words, more than one of the same value. I'm sorry, not unique. All right? So once we've done that, the next step is to create a shared column that links or relates those two tables. So in this case, between film and film actor, let's take a look at implementing the foreign key constraint in MySQL. The top half of this whiteboard shows the SQL code, and then down below we've got an illustration. What we're doing here in this example, and this actually mirrors what we're going to do in the demo shortly, is we'll build a parent table and a child table and match them by a certain column. What you're seeing down below is we have the parent table is going to have just a single column called ID. The child table will also have an ID column, but it will have a matched column, a foreign key column, that comes back and references the parent table. So that's what we've got physically. Now, as far as the code, we're first running create table and defining our ID column as an integer with not null. So therefore, we've got to have some value for every row in that ID column. And we're also affixing the primary key constraint to the ID column in the parent table. All well and good, that's pretty straightforward. You'll notice also we complete the statement using the engine clause to ensure that we're using the NODB engine, which supports foreign keys. So much for the parent table. Next, we'll create the child table. We'll lead off with an ID column that is going to need a primary key constraint. I don't see this in the code here. I must have forgot about it, but you know that we'll have to add primary key ID to this column declaration. The second column in the child table will be called parent ID, and note that we're using the same data type on the child table as we are on the parent. The name does not have to be the same, but the data type does. You'll notice that in the child table, we're calling the column parent underscore ID and not just ID. In fact, we can't do that because our ID column in the child table would prevent us from doing that. Now, when you add the foreign key constraint, an index will automatically be created on the parent ID column. You don't have to use the index statement for that column. Here, it's being put in for completeness. But just like when we create a primary key constraint on a table, MySQL builds an index. The same thing happens when you use the foreign key statement. Now, the foreign key statement is important. It's got three main parts. It's got the foreign key declaration where you pass in the name of the column in the local table to which the foreign key constraint is going to be applied. Next, you provide the references keyword and then pass in the specific table and column that this child, this foreign key column, is referring. So in this case, we're referencing the parent table, and in the parent table, the ID column. And then finally and optionally, you have delete update and delete cascade. You can add them both, you can add one or the other, or you could ignore the cascade update and cascade deletes. They're pretty powerful, actually. So you want to think twice before you turn on cascading in a foreign key relationship. What delete cascade will do is, let's say we have a parent ID 5 that's referenced in three rows over here on the child table. Delete cascade means if we delete the 5 parent in the parent table, then the cascade will come to the related table and remove the entire rows that reference that parent ID 5. And that makes sense from a referential integrity standpoint, because if we nuked parent ID 5, we can't have orphan parent ID 5s on the child table. So in some business cases, delete cascade works well. Others, you absolutely want to avoid it. If, for instance, for archival purposes, you needed to maintain the rest of that row data. Other RDBMSs like SQL Server give you a little bit more flexibility, such that instead of deleting the rows, you could reset these orphaned values to a default or to a null or something else. You see what I mean? But here we're talking about actually nuking out the rows. Delete update is kind of cool. Here, if a parent ID value changed, the change would be cascaded down to any related tables. In our demo, we're going to build two tables and then relate them. And then, of course, we're going to need to use the InnoDB storage engine for this. And then we're going to play around with all of the other methods for ensuring data integrity that we learned about in this nugget. We'll work with null values, defaults, and of course the foreign key constraint. The test wouldn't be complete unless we validate that it works. So that's how we'll finish the demo. Let's get to work. This ought to be pretty fun. In this demonstration, we're going to work with data integrity and constraints in MySQL 5.x. And as you see, we're on MySQL Nugget. This is a Windows Server 2008 server. I've opened up my my.ini option file, and the reason why is because I wanted to show you where in the file we can set the SQL mode. Looks like a little before halfway through the file, we have a commented line that says set the SQL mode to strict, and then we have SQL-mode equals, and then between double quotes, you can put your modes. And notice that more than one mode is supported. On my server, I have strict trans tables, no auto create user, no engine substitution. Now that's pretty harsh, no engine substitution. Now you can create as many, be as flexible as you want, depending upon how strict you want your MySQL server to behave. Hit up the MySQL reference manual for a full description of all of these SQL modes. As you've come to expect, you can change any server variable while you're in a MySQL session by using the set command. So if we wanted to, for the sake of this session, override the SQL mode, we could say or type set SQL underscore mode equals, and then between single ticks, whatever we want. Now, if you pass in empty parameters, what that'll do is set your SQL mode to null and basically put MySQL in as permissive a mode as humanly possible. To view the current session SQL mode, we can run select against the global variable at session, this is case insensitive actually, I'm just capitalizing it for grins, dot SQL underscore mode. And of course our session SQL mode is blank. Another thing you can do is select against at global dot SQL mode. And global is going to pull from the option file what you have there. So keep that in mind. We can select against the session variable to see what we're dealing with in this session. And globally on server startup, we have a much stricter setup. Now remember, by nullifying or turning off SQL mode, this is allowing MySQL server to do data type conversions all day long. It'll do string to date, string to number, and so on. And again, that may be fine for your business needs. Just be aware of that behavior. All right, so the next thing on our chopping block is to build out two tables that will be related, and in so doing, we'll play with some various constraints. Now, one difference, you'll find several differences really between operating systems, but one unfortunate difference between Windows-based MySQL and Linux-based SQL is this backslash exclamation point. You'll remember in Linux environments, you could just quickly duck out of MySQL, come out into your shell, execute a command, and then come back to MySQL by using this escape character, a space, and then your shell statement. Unfortunately, you'll find that this doesn't work in Windows-based MySQL, unfortunately. So it says unknown command, I can do backslash C to get back to my MySQL prompt. Oh well. So if I want to clear the screen, I guess I'm going to actually have to exit out of MySQL, clear the screen, and then log back in. Now, in this example, we're going to create two tables. Instead of parent and child, as you saw on the whiteboard, we're going to use customers and orders, the traditional example that you have with teachers presenting relational tables, right? So to kick things off, let's first show our databases and see what we've got to work with. And we're going to create a database called FK, just for grins. And then we'll use FK and build our table from there. And as you can see from the code I put in, we're creating a table called customers that has just a single column called cust underscore ID. We're using the integer data type. We're specifying not null. Remember, the default is null. In other words, nulls are allowed. We're overriding that here, and we're attaching the primary key constraint to that cust ID column, and finally, we're specifying the InnoDB engine. We'll send this command to MySQL, and that was okay. Now, we can verify the code behind the table, you'll remember, by saying show create table customers, and I'll do a backslash G. And we see that we have create table customers, cust ID. It's basically all of every bit of code we added. No big surprise there. Good deal. So now we'll build our orders table. All right, let's take a look at our code for our orders table. We have the order ID column that's going to be the primary key for this table. Again, integer, not null, is the data type I've selected. Next, we're bringing in our related column from the customers table. Cust ID, we're using same data type as it existed in the other side of the relationship, again, not null. We have our foreign key statement, where we're attaching the constraint to our local cust ID column, but referencing the cust ID column and the one side of the relationship, the customers table. I'm turning on cascade delete and cascade update. We're closing out our column declarations and then specifying the InnoDB database. All right, so we can say show tables from FK, and we have customers and orders just like we'd expect to. Let's insert some values into the customers table. We're using the insert statement here. Insert into customers, we just have the one column. And note that we're providing multiple row values in a single statement, which is perfectly valid. Your value sets or your rows have to be enclosed in parentheses, and each row you're adding has to be separated with a comma. So we're adding values 1 and 2, which should go in fine because of the integer data type. And then we're passing in default, which is the same thing as saying a null value for that column. Now you'll remember we set our SQL mode to its most permissive setting. But on the other hand, in our customer's table definition, we specified not null for that column. Therefore, let's see what happens. Didn't like that. It told us we have an error in the syntax, okay? Well, how about we use null instead? Still doesn't like that. How about if we do parentheses 3? Okay, well, that was just fine. So we can say select star from customers, and we've got customer ID 1, 2, and 3. Now, what if we wanted to insert into customers value 1 again? What do you think? Nope, duplicate entry 1 for key primary. This is an example of the primary key constraint preventing us from putting duplicate values into the table. How about if we specified a string value? We'll put 4 in single ticks. Seemed to like that. So if we run again, select star from customers, we see that that 4 was type converted for us based on our SQL mode. Interesting, interesting, interesting. Now why don't we insert some data in the orders table? All right, so we're saying insert into orders, and we're going to populate both columns, order ID and customer ID, with the following value pairs, 11213242. So you see we do have some duplication. That refers to one-to-many relationship. So it tells us four rows affected, four duplicates. Well, let's see what that means. We'll run select from orders, and sure enough, we have our four unique order IDs, and we have customer information. Now, of course, the next question is, what if we tried to put in values for customer ID here on the order side that didn't exist on the customer side? So we know that customers, we have 1 through 4. How about if we add values, we'll say order ID 5, that ought to be okay because of our primary key constraint, but we'll say customer ID 5. What do you think is going to happen here? Will this break our referential integrity? Because we don't have a customer ID 5. Sure enough, cannot add or update the child row because of that issue. The next thing I'd like to do is test the cascade delete feature of our foreign key relationship. So what you see on our bottom line here is that I'll use the delete statement, which of course we're going to learn all about. We'll learn more about insert and delete in separate nuggets as we go along. However, I hope that you're developing a little bit of familiarity and comfortability with these DML statements, just as we're using them in our work. We can run delete from customers where the customer ID equals 1. So we're going to lose customer ID 1 as soon as I press enter and issue the statement to the SQL parser. The question will be, what will happen then to the related table orders? Because as you see, order IDs 1 and 2 both have the customer ID value 1 indicated. Will this foreign key constraint and the cascade delete actually work? Well, it told us it did. We can verify by running a select from orders, and we see now that we have just order ID 3 and order ID 4. So that shows the great power of cascade delete and cascade update. For completeness, let's test the cascade update as well. So if I issue the update DML statement by saying update customers and to set the customer ID to 10 where it's existing 2, you'll see what happens there. Let's scroll back up to where we have our customers output. So we're going to update or change customer ID 2 to 10. Now the ramifications that should have on orders are that both order ID 3 and 4 should now reference customer ID 10 instead of customer ID 2. Let's again do a select star from orders, and we see that that cascade update has taken place. Cascade update can work really well for string columns, especially for last names. Think of it this way. If Jane Doe gets married and becomes Jane Doe Smith or Jane Smith, it would be nice to be able to update her record in the employees table and automatically have any related references to her last name in other tables update as well. So that's just another example of how this data integrity works when you're using foreign key and cascade update, cascade delete. The very last thing we're going to do in this demo is work with the default constraint. I'll show you how that works. And to do that, why don't we run a show create table on customers just to see what we've got going on with that. We'll recall that we have just a single column. And let's add a second column called name that uses the varchar data type. Now, how can we do that? We've referred to this technique in a previous nugget. We can run alter table customers add and then the name of our new column. We'll just call it name, and then we'll specify the data type. I'll call it varchar 20, and we can throw in default, and then in a string value we're going to need to delimit with single ticks. I'll just call the default value customer. How's that? We'll finish with a semicolon and the query's okay. Now if we run the show create table again, we see that we have our second column. And if we do a select all from customers, we just have the default value automatically added. So in other words, when you add a default to an already existing table, retroactively MySQL fills in that data. So when we do inserts now, we can either override the default by providing a different name, or we could submit the default or null keywords and have the default come in automatically. Implementing constraints review. Boy, we covered a lot of good ground in this nugget. I hope you're as pleased with your learning as I am in transmitting the information to you. The first thing we did is learn how MySQL supports the handling of invalid, or I'll even add, missing data values. So we know about stuff like SQL mode, we know about nullability, default values, we know that we can't officially use the check constraint in MySQL, but we can create trigger code to emulate check behavior on columns. And we spent time implementing those table constraints. The centerpiece of our discussion was the foreign key support and ability to create referential integrity between related tables using the features of the InnoDB transactional storage engine. I hope that this has been informative for you, and I'd like to thank you for viewing.